There's a couple different industries that's pandemic-proof, and drugs is one of them that's never gonna stop.
The numbers of overdose and death are astronomical. We're gonna look back on 2020, we as a society, and see a lot of mistakes we made. Isolating people with mental health and addiction issues, and that's not a small number of people. You know, addiction represents 15 to 20% of Americans.
When this is over, you're gonna find bodies in apartments alone.
It's been months since COVID-19 brought the U.S. to a standstill, upending the lives of millions of Americans. And while states around the nation grapple with how to return to a new normal, many people have started to notice the indirect effects that COVID has had on millions of people struggling with substance abuse around the U.S., a deadly impact that experts worry will persist long after the pandemic is over.
Let me know when we're set. Good to go?
Cool. Tell me a little bit about the impacts that you have seen over the last few months of the coronavirus pandemic on folks who are struggling with substance abuse and folks who are seeking recovery.
We're in the middle of an epidemic that's been forgotten. We are rising. So when we look at opioid overdoses, they're going up. When we're looking at treatment access, it's going down. We have lots and lots of folks that were actually in a stable recovery for one of the highest groups of readmissions that we're seeing right now. Folks that were clean and sober for 1 to 2 years that have lost complete touch with their support groups. They've lost, and this is an illness that thrives on isolation.
Now, addicts and alcoholics need this face-to-face interaction. Some of them rely on it for their sobriety, and they are not taking this quarantine lightly.
I'd like to kind of go back to early March with you and hear a little bit about when the stay-at-home orders were being rolled out across the country. What sorts of things were you most concerned about, and have any of those worst-case scenarios transpired?
So industry-wide, some of our immediate concerns had to do with access to treatment and whatnot.
You'll see a huge trend starting in March in overdose, and death just climbs. It's massive. So the isolation, more people buying alcohol, more people buying drugs, more people committing suicide, more people just spending time by themselves. I don't know if you can hear that in the background. There's people laughing, right? There's people telling jokes here in our clinic. There's people connecting. That's what keeps us accountable, keeps us in the light.
At Prevention Point, a syringe exchange in Kensington, Philadelphia, a neighborhood is facing its own opioid crisis, and the effects of COVID have touched the roots of this community when it comes to caring for a high homeless population.
Something to eat? So we kind of had to shut down normal operations and move everything to the street. So what we're doing outside this morning is serving breakfast. This is how we do breakfast every morning, just like from the door. We're handing people a sandwich and coffee. Community is really important for people. And in some ways, we've lost that a little bit because people can't be proximate. Like, it's literally dangerous to be close to one another. And also for the folks that we serve, it's safest for them to be close to one another. The drop-in center predominantly sees folks who are experiencing homelessness and coming in to access one of our services. So people can come inside, hang out, watch TV, get food, get coffee, and then they sign in for services at the front desk. Obviously, all of our services have been really affected by COVID. This room normally at this time would be full of people. But as you can see, you know, there's only chairs for 9-10 people in here right now. Whereas normally the chairs would be like this close together, and there would be like 5 rows of chairs, and the room would be pretty packed already this early in the morning. And it was like a really warm, welcoming, inviting space, and now has to be kind of spread out, and it feels like empty and definitely very, very different. I think it's just that constant like battle in my head of like, do we allow more people in this space so that, but then there's the potential risk of exposure and COVID, or do we keep more folks outside, which means that we'll probably end up seeing folks with a lot of frostbite and things like that, but at least everyone is like safer from COVID. This is a scenario in which it feels particularly difficult to make these decisions. And I imagine the winter is going to be like the most difficult. Today I am going to the funeral of one of the very first participants that I ever worked with here at Prevention Point, who passed away from an overdose a week and a half ago. About providing community for folks doesn't just feel good, but it actually is life-saving.
There has been an increase in relapse, and also, unfortunately, we're hearing that that there's also been an increase in fatalities from overdoses. So it's not just that people are relapsing, but they are taking drugs in ways that are dangerous and is leading to a fatality.
The overdose fatalities have really increased. By mid-March, we were already at about 55% more than we were the year before. And that was really before COVID hit. And then COVID hit. It's been almost catastrophic.
Is there a driving force behind that? I mean, was that consistent with sort of the drugs that you were seeing used in 2019, or did something change suddenly?
The DEA and the USAS have speculated certain drugs have been difficult to obtain due to COVID and transit issues. So what the thought is that people are mixing, for example, cocaine and methamphetamine with fentanyl. And then there's a certain section of the population who have no idea, who don't want to get into opiates and are using cocaine thinking I'm safe. And they're not, because fentanyl is being cut into the cocaine.
They're not getting the drug that they're used to self-administering. And so their controls on dosage are all over the map. They don't actually know what they're putting in their body at that moment. And it's so easy to die.
The moment that there was social distancing, it became clear that the methadone clinics could not operate the way that they were. So that led to actually being unable to deliver treatments. The SAMHSA, which is the organization that provides with the treatment for substance use disorder, make a provision that allows now for the methadone clinics to give take home methadone for 1 month, so you don't need to go there on a daily basis, which makes it so much easier for patients to be compliant. The other change that has made it easier was it is now possible for a physician, so I can prescribe via a cell phone, an application, telehealth, which I couldn't do in the past. I had to see physically the person.
COVID-19 has had wide-reaching impacts on what's often referred to as medication-assisted recovery, treatment that includes substances like methadone that traditionally relied on frequent in-person visits. In Philadelphia, this new reality has changed operations for Prevention Point's Suboxone Clinic, who had to suspend their mobile unit when the pandemic hit.
We do telehealth visits for folks that do have phones, but if you don't, you could come to the building and they meet with the case manager, and the case manager arranges for a telephone or a video conference with their provider.
Actually, since the pandemic has started, the enrollment in our Suboxone program has grown by about 30%. So despite all of the challenges of like maintaining those things like social distancing and mask rules and all of those things, we've actually been able to provide a greater, like a larger amount of treatment than ever before.
Okay, Dr. Barclay, here's Elwood.
Well, today I came to Prevention Point because I have a telehealth appointment with Dr. Barclay to get my prescription for Suboxone refill. I'm in recovery for opiate use. I started out taking pills, and it's kind of weird because I started out taking pills that were prescribed to me by a doctor. Yeah, so that kind of kickstarted my drug habit.
How's the medication working for you?
It's working good. You know, I find myself sometimes, you know, maybe having to take like a little piece, like, you know, a little bit more, but it's definitely doing the job though.
Don't you run out a little early then?
Yes.
When did you run out this month?
Yeah, this month I ran out. It was like a day and a half early. The pandemic right now, this is a perfect excuse for everybody who has to stop using drugs but doesn't want to stop using drugs, because they can be like, oh, well, it's a pandemic. I can't be around all them people, so I'll go to rehab in a couple months, you know. This world is changing, or should I say it changed because that shit is permanent. There's no going back to the way it was. Like, this is what it is now. Mask and gloves. Getting telehealth appointments. I just started telehealth like 2 months ago, and it's a lot easier because, you know, the doctor, he's probably got a very busy schedule, and, you know, and I'm not trying to sit around waiting for him for 4 hours. I could just talk to him, like, wherever I'm at. Now, I don't have to worry about anything. You know, I could just live my life like a normal person, like I am.
Treatment for substances has moved increasingly online, which has been beneficial for some, but it's not a perfect solution for everyone.
Have there been any unique issues that your facility has had to learn to adapt to, in the months since we all found ourselves in the stay-at-home situation?
What we saw in late March, mid to late March, was AA meeting halls, 12-step meeting halls, close.
If you are dealing with a substance use disorder that we don't think much about, yet it's very prevalent, is alcohol use disorder. There's a store in the corner of my house, and it's been open, and it's a liquor store, and it was packed. I mean, I couldn't believe how packed it was. And this is exactly what people are actually commenting. The consumption of alcohol in our country has gone up during COVID. We know that because we're monitoring the sales of alcohol.
What we normally rely upon within the community as far as 12-step engagement, human connection, has really been reduced to such a degree that it's made it very difficult for people getting out of treatment or getting sober for the first time to have genuine, authentic human connection with other people that understand. We were doing one of our outpatient programs we were running on Zoom, wasn't working very well. Some groups are starting to meet privately in homes, things like that. It personally, in my life, I've been going to some small 12-step groups that are not hosted in regular meeting halls. They're hosted at people's homes, people's backyards. That's been a huge lifesaver. Putting somebody through the rigors of treatment, which is a very difficult process emotionally, spiritually, physically to go through, and then to just cut them loose and hope they make good choices is a recipe for disaster. 2020 is the year of unrest in so many different ways. And a lot of people are feeling different levels of anxiety and frustration around a lot of issues. And they need a space to air that stuff out and talk about it.
Looking forward, do you think the pandemic is going to have any lasting impacts on the ways that we look at treatment and recovery for substance abuse issues in this country?
I would be surprised if it doesn't, absolutely. And I hope that it's going to have some positive effects. I would hope that we learn that we don't need to be so draconian on the way that we deliver, for example, methadone treatment. That giving flexibility to patients can actually result in better outcomes. We will learn how to also optimally utilize telehealth to provide the support that individuals need for their recovery. I hope that will sustain that movement that has been generated by realizing how disparate the outcomes are with the pandemic.
For folks that are living on the streets, experiencing homelessness, using substances, they are each other's community, and we are so privileged to get to be a part of that.